Right, so we've looked at a couple of suction pumps, we've looked at direct action pump, we've looked at one deep well pump, which was the India Mark II, which was a traditional design of cylinder, a one which has a reducer on the top. We're now going to look at another popular design of deep well pump, which has an open top cylinder. And this is the cylinder itself. It's plastic, but it's lined with stainless steel or brass. So what we have at the top of the pump head here is a plastic pipe which is hanging from a conical shaped rubber which rests in a conical shaped metal support. When it's installed, this is being glued, so there's two ropes that run down the side of this pipe to the bottom of the cylinder, and the glued pipe is lowered into the borehole. So it's good because it's corrosion resistant. So the cylinder stays down the borehole in this type. There's a foot valve like this at the bottom of the cylinder. The foot valve has a hook on the top so we can remove it. You'll see it on the other video when we remove the actual one. So this clips into the bottom of the cylinder here. And there's a rubber ring on it to stop water leaking around it, and there's four lugs on it that are slightly flexible, so that will clip into the bottom of the cylinder. So there's a plastic female section here that receives the male clips, so they clip into the bottom of the cylinder, so that stays at the bottom. That's our suction valve or our foot valve. So just like we've seen on all the other ones, it has a plastic valve which is, or a valve which is moving up and down as we are doing the pumping motion. So that fixed down the bottom there, but we can remove it through the rising main. To remove it, we need to use a fishing tool. So this here is our fishing tool, and as you see, it has a hook on it which can open and close. So what happens is, as we lower it down, eventually we will hook onto the foot valve and then we can pull the foot valve out. So that's the way in which we can remove the foot valve from the cylinder. We can remove the rods, we can lower this down all the way down the borehole on the rods, and we can hook on to the foot valve and we can pull it out of the cylinder. We don't need to touch the pipe. Within the cylinder, we will again have a piston operating up and down, reciprocating, which as before will have a seal on it and has got a valve within the piston that's opening and closing. So as we've seen before, when we pull the piston up, the foot valve will open and allow water to enter the cylinder. When we're pushing that down, the foot valve will close and this valve will open, as we saw on the animation. All these cylinders are working in the same way. So we have the foot valve clipped in down the bottom. We have the piston which is moving up and down in the cylinder here, and because it's an open top cylinder, we can pull that whole thing out. We can then put our fishing tool in to fish out the foot valve. So that's the beauty of it. It's an open top cylinder, much easier than the traditional design which has the reducer on and we have to lift the pipes and the rods. We still need to lift the rods on this pump, but we don't need to lift the pipes, so it's a much lighter lift. Now let's have a look at the way rods can be connected in pumps. The traditional method is a screwed rod, where you have the end of the rod has a thread on it which screws into a coupling. You can see this rod here is galvanized, but it's already started rusting. This rod maybe used to be galvanized, but it's already pitted and rusting. So that's a disadvantage of galvanized rods. So once these are screwed together, you use a lock nut usually to tighten the joint so it doesn't come unscrewed. Either side on this one, we got some plastic centralizers. So when the rod's moving up and down in the pipe, there's no danger of this coupling actually rubbing on the inside of the pipe, making a hole in it or damaging any corrosion protection on the inside of the pipe. So that's a traditional design of rod connector, not necessarily exactly the same as here, but the same principle. And on the India Mark II, we would have that sort of connector operating inside the pipe here. And when we're removing it, once we take a pipe out, we should discover the connector. We would then undo the connector and take the rod and the pipe off. On the Afridev, they've got some alternatives to that. One of which is a hooked rod. So this is quite a clever design, where once you've pulled the eye out of the rising main, you can push a hook through it. Then you can rotate it through 90 degrees, and then this can operate up and down in the rising main with a centralizer to stop the connection wearing a hole in the plastic pipe. So in this one, because it's an open top cylinder, we can pull it up and open the joint. So it's much easier than where we have a screwed joint. Here's another example of a screwed joint, where we'd have to pull it up, undo the lock nut, undo the screwed rods. Unfortunately, there have been some problems with the hooked rods, which means some people have gone back to using a screwed rod for the Afridev. But I rather like the hooked rods if they're well designed and manufactured. These ones are stainless steel, and even the connectors stainless steel here. So that means we've got corrosion resistant pipe, we've got corrosion resistant rod, and in this case, a fast connection device. So let's just have a look inside the head of this pump. So to open the head, we're just undoing a single bolt on the side here. And we're taking the head off. We have a connection to the rod at the top here, which is going to be forming an arc as we lift the handle up and down. So it's forming an arc as we are pumping. On the Afridev, you have an opportunity to actually extend your handle for deeper settings to give yourself some additional leverage. So you can undo this bolt, you can slide the handle out. It's pivoting around here, so this is our pivot bearing. There's another pivot at the top here from which the rod is hanging. As we are moving, this is forming an arc around this point here, so the rod is moving slightly from side to side. You'll see on another video quite what these components are, because we're actually going to be removing them. One of the unique features about this hand pump is it actually uses plastic bearings, two different types of plastic that rotate on each other, and that bearing is sitting on a metal rod. The inside plastic isn't rotating, it's just the outside plastic rotating. The advantage of this, it's very cheap to manufacture. It doesn't last very long, maybe maximum of 2 years, but the design is that every year this is replaced, and they can be very easily replaced by the community if the spares are available in the country. Another feature of this hand pump is that you can use different arrangements of piston. And this here is a brass piston, a one-piece brass piston, which can replace the plastic piston here. It's also corrosion resistant to a fair degree, so it's rather like the plastic. So this can replace this in the same cylinder. In this particular case, you can note there's a screw on the bottom of the piston. That's because this design, which is used on a version of the Afridev, is so that you can remove the foot valve. So this is the foot valve, which replaces the plastic component, has the same single valve in it. The seal at the bottom remains in a conical brass seating. And the design is such that you can lower your piston to below where it normally operates, and you can screw these two components together to pull the whole thing out through your rising main, instead of using the hook system and the fishing tool, which I showed you earlier. This is a similar design to the India Mark III, which, if you remember, I also told you is an open top cylinder. That also has a screwed connection. So that's it with regard to the introduction to reciprocating rod pumps. We've looked at the suction pump, where the cylinder is above ground. We've looked at the direct action pump, where the cylinder is below water level, but we can't lift more than about 15 meters. We've looked at two types of deep well pump, the India Mark II, where certain designs can lift from as deep as 90 meters. And we've finally looked at the Afridev here, where it's more corrosion resistant than the India Mark II. Again, we can easily lift from 45 meters with certain adaptations and support of the plastic rising main from the bottom. We can lift from about 90 meters. Just to say that even with a reciprocating rod pump, you can motorize it if you take the lever handle off and you use a crank shaft and a connection rod. So you'll see here that as the handle is rotated, we are turning the rotation motion into reciprocating motion. So we have a rotating flywheel here leading to reciprocating motion. So we have a deep well pump here. This is the Volanta. We have a deep well pump which could be motorized. It's designed for use by hand here on this flywheel, but because we have a flywheel, we could use a flat belt on here and a petrol engine with a drive on it, and it could be motorized. So we can motorize reciprocating rod pumps, but it's quite rare. But this is one of the few ones we have here which show that option. So we've looked at two suction pumps, we looked at a direct action pump, we've looked at two deep well pumps, and this last one was the Afridev that we were looking at. Just to finish off this introductory video, we're going to look at three other pumps that don't operate on this reciprocating rod principle, which I've kept on talking about. So we're going to first look at the progressive cavity pump, then we're going to look at the diaphragm hose pump, and then finally we're going to look at the rope and washer pump, sometimes just called the rope pump. So let's move to looking at the progressive cavity pump.